President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. proposes a moratorium on electric bill payments in areas hit by severe tropical storm Christine. The storm has left many areas under a state of calamity, with the death toll now rising to 125. We have this report.
More deaths are reported in the Philippines from the onslaught of severe tropical storm Christine. Authorities raised the death toll Tuesday to 125, with 28 more persons still missing. The overall cost of damage left by the storm has reached 4.3 billion pesos. It destroyed crops worth 2.8 billion pesos, while damage to infrastructure stood at 1.5 billion. About 500,000 households in storm-ravaged areas remain without power. The National Electrification Administration says power has already been restored in most areas, except for some parts of Pangasinan, Batangas, and the Bicol region.
Restoration is still ongoing on the areas of Pangasinan, under the franchise area of Panelco 1, Batelec 1 in the areas of Nasugbu and Calatagan, Batangas, Aleco, Albay Electric Cooperative, Casoreco 2 covering the areas of Naga, and Casoreco 3 covering the area of Iriga in the Bicol region. We are already almost fully energized on most of the areas aside from these areas that I mentioned earlier.
President Marcos Jr. directed the Energy Regulatory Commission to study the possible implementation of temporary relief on electricity bill payments in areas under a state of calamity due to severe tropical storm Christine. Meanwhile, the U.S. has sent aid worth 84 million pesos to support Manila's relief efforts for storm victims in the Bicol region and in the province of Batangas. Authorities are also bracing for yet another potentially catastrophic storm in Typhoon Leon.
Ang ginawa natin, ina-assume natin na maaaring merong numero ng ang number of families that might be affected or potentially going to be affected is 500,000 plus families or 2.5 million individuals. So yung level ng preparasyon natin, meaning ang DSWD with their family food packs, tubig, kami sa Office of Civil Defense for the non-food items, ganong karami ang taong tinitingnan natin na dapat handa tayong matulungan in case talagang tumama ng di maganda na naman ang bagyong Leon.
The Supreme Court has temporarily blocked PhilHealth from completing the transfer of its alleged excess funds to the National Treasury. Petitioners opposing the transfer are advocating now for the return of all funds to the state health insurer. The details from Paige Javier.
The Supreme Court has put on hold the transfer of 89.9 billion pesos in unused funds of PhilHealth to the National Treasury. The move granted the prayers of three petitions, challenging the return of the funds to state coffers to fund unprogrammed appropriations. The petitioners include various groups led by Senate Minority Leader Aquilino Coco Pimentel, Bayan Muna, and Sangbayan Coalition led by retired Supreme Court Associate Justice Antonio Carpio. They question the constitutionality of the fund transfer.
The Supreme Court issued a temporary restraining order to enjoin the further transfer of PhilHealth funds to the National Treasury. The TRO is effective immediately.
So far, the PhilHealth has transferred 60 billion pesos to the National Treasury. 20 billion was remitted in May, 10 billion in August, and another 30 billion this month. When asked if the funds already transferred will be returned, SC spokesperson Camille Su Mei Ting answered in the negative.
That was not the subject of the TRO. So the TRO is just really to prevent the further transfer of more funds from PhilHealth to the National Treasury.
PhilHealth spokesperson Israel Parga said they will follow the decision of the High Court. Ting said the High Court issued the TRO likely because of the allegations in the pleadings and comments. The High Court required Sambayan Coalition to file their comments within a non-extendable period of 10 days from receipt of notice. PhilHealth President and CEO Emmanuel Ledesma Jr. said they respect and will fully abide by the SC decision. The state insurer adds they remain focused on their mission to provide Filipinos adequate financial protection against health risks. In a separate statement, Finance Secretary Ralph Recto said the department will respect and comply with the SC decision. Recto maintained that the move to gather idle, unused, and excess funds of government-owned and controlled corporations is a mandate under law, adding that they consulted government's legal experts. He also said they got favorable legal opinion that PhilHealth's unused funds are not part of its reserve funds or income, which is restricted under the Universal Health Care Act. Solicitor General Menardo Guevara said the TRO is limited to the final tranche of the fund transfer, meaning it does not affect remittances of balances of other GOCCs. Meanwhile, petitioners welcome the TRO. Retired Supreme Court Associate Justice Antonio Carpio thanked the SC for the move. He is hopeful the executive branch will return the transferred funds to PhilHealth. Former Bayan Muna Congressman Nery Colmenares said the TRO is a significant victory for the Filipino people, especially PhilHealth beneficiaries. He said the decision prevents what he called a grave injustice from occurring. The oral arguments on the petitions are set for January 14, 2025. Paige Javier, ABS-CBN News.
Professional information provider Walter Skluer pledges to bridge critical healthcare data gaps in the Philippines and beyond. By bridging this divide, the company aims to support healthcare systems and improve patient treatment standards through reliable and real-time data, tailored to the evolving needs of medical practitioners and their patients.
We then provide what you rightly called out at the start, evidence-based information at the clinician's fingertips. And you might be surprised to know, but you know, today 60% of questions that go unanswered during a consultation. So we're really putting all of that latest and up-to-date information into the clinician's hands across all of our the hospitals. And the biggest problem, you have no idea where that information is coming from, who developed it, and is it the right action to take. What we do with from Walter Skluer through up to date, we actually provide from specialists who provide all of the evidence-based information. It goes through a very rigorous editorial process on our side, which really differentiates us from everybody else, frankly. And I know now as a clinician, and we've had clinicians come back to us and say, it really feels like I have, you know, all of your 7,000 to 8,000 specialists over my shoulder supporting me.
The Philippines eyes the creation of the so-called Internet of Things industry, poised to ignite a new wave of economic growth. The details from Jackie Pascual.
The Department of Information and Communications Technology is pushing for the creation of a framework or roadmap for Internet of Things, or IoT. IoT refers to a network of devices, appliances, vehicles, or other objects embedded with sensors or software and are linked together through the Internet. At a press briefing for the IoT Conference 2024, DICT Director Emilu Versosa Delfin says, based on a study, the Philippine IoT market value is expected to hit 164 billion pesos this year and will continue to rise.
By the end of 2029, ang projection na total market volume no could reach 410 billion pesos. So in other words, malaking potential.
Packet Works, one of the organizers of the conference, agrees on the huge impact of IoT on the economy. It makes business processes more efficient and can also be a source of additional employment.
IoT is all about increasing efficiency and productivity. So not changing anything by just applying, you know, IoT, being able to monitor and measure your performance, we can be more globally competitive and increase our GDP by at least 10%.
The most common example of IoT is the smart home, where appliances are connected with each other and can be controlled by the user anywhere. But officials say IoT covers all sectors.
IoT can do a lot in different verticals, healthcare, education, logistics, transportation, and very relevant, yun nga, sa disaster risks, sa climate change.
Internet of Things connects everything else. Your water meter, your power meter, weather stations, you know, your chair, you know, your fitness tracker. When all of this data goes to the cloud in one place, you can then use analytics to make sense of the data and find insights.
Several telco players are also expanding internet connectivity as a response to the growing demand for fast and reliable connection. Converge is developing a new system for smart homes, while Dito recently launched its 5G RedCap technology, a suitable tech for IoT devices.
We have a smart home together with Experience Box. The Experience Box, we serve you smart homes, which is IoT we come in. IoT sensor for lighting, IoT sensor for curtain, IoT sensor for leakage of gas, anything is smart home.
It's only used in manufacturing, tsaka industrial, you know, zones. But this time around, we were able to introduce it into the home applications. No? So it's the first time globally that we're launching something like this.
Organizers say IoT is still at its infancy stage in the Philippines, but they hope more Filipinos will be more aware of IoT technology, particularly students. They believe the Philippines can easily be not just a consumer, but an exporter of IoT tech. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
David Charlton, the founder and CEO of popular beauty salon chain David Salon, has passed away. Born in Sutherland, England in 1955, Charlton began his career in hairdressing at the age of 16 and later moved to the Philippines in 1978. He founded David Salon in 1989, expanding it to over 200 branches, including a few internationally. His wake will be held from October 30 to November 2. Over in Canada, Filipinos assess the government's move to sharply cut the number of immigrants it will allow into the country in the next 3 years. Rowena Papasin tells us more.
Faced with a housing crisis and an unprecedented population growth, Canada is drastically cutting new immigration for the first time in years. From 2025 to 2027, Canada will bring in a total of 1.1 million new permanent residents, a 21% drop from previous years. Prime Minister Justin Trudeau said the move aims to give all levels of government time to catch up and make the necessary investments in various social services to accommodate more people in the future.
We will reduce the number of immigrants we bring in over the next 3 years, which will result in a pause in the population growth over the next 2 years.
Canada's previous target for 2025 and 2026 is 500,000 each year, but this will be reduced to less than 400,000 until 2027. Immigration Minister Mark Miller said the government will instead prioritize the processing of temporary residents who are already in Canada.
The current plan reduces next year's projections from 500,000 permanent residents to 395,000, a net reduction of 105,000 permanent residents immediately in 2025. After that, in 2026, a progression down to 380 to stabilize the numbers at 365 in 2027.
Miller said this means the government will not have to build 670,000 housing units in the next 3 years. The government has also reduced the issuance of new study permits by 43%, which Miller said resulted in lower rents in Vancouver, Surrey, and Toronto. Prime Minister Trudeau added unscrupulous businesses have also taken advantage of foreign workers, while many colleges and universities have also exploited the international student program.
Under the watch of provinces, some colleges and universities are bringing in more international students than communities can accommodate, treating them as an expendable means to line their own pockets. That's unacceptable, and it needs to change.
Many Filipino-Canadians welcomed this announcement. One of them is student Jill Saulon, who said it's unfair that some use fraudulent means to get in.
At least sana mag-follow din instructions.
Another student, Liana Espiritu, said many businesses prefer to hire international students than locals.
It's just a bit biased and unfair to those who are living here, how they can't seem to get any jobs while students, international students can. Even I still struggle in my high school classes with international students.
For his part, migrant worker Jun De Leon expressed hope that Canada will also help those who are already here in the country.
Okay lang din magbawas, pero sana matulungan din nila yung local saka yung mga nandito na. Sana doon sila mag-focus. Kesa doon sa yung paparating.
Canada's population grew by more than 1 million since January 2023. Statistics Canada also reported that the number of temporary residents rose to 805,000, most of whom are temporary foreign workers. Rowena Papasin, ABS-CBN News, Vancouver.
Veteran broadcast journalist Rico Hizon set to return to television. Join him on Beyond the Exchange with Rico Hizon, a weekly primetime program where he talks to industry leaders, entrepreneurs, and iconic personalities who will share their insights, their expertise, and stories of hope. Catch the premiere episode on November 5, that's Tuesday, at 6 p.m. here on ANC and online via the ANC 24/7 YouTube page.